This hearing will now come to order. Good morning and welcome to today's hearing entitled Building a Science of Economics for the Real World. I know that economists must think that politicians are impossible to please. Harry Truman complained that he wanted a one-handed economist, and now we're complaining that we got very confident, unequivocal economic advice in the last decade or so, but that one-handed advice proved to be wrong. Unemployment is hovering at just under 10%, more than 16% when you include the folks who have given up looking for work or who are working part-time when they really want a full-time job. Banks have cash but aren't lending. The Federal Reserve can't lower interest rates anymore without paying banks to take the money. There's worried talk of a deflationary spiral like the one that's dogged Japan for almost two decades now. And arguments about whether it is better to stimulate the economy or cut the deficit appear backed more by ideology, almost theology, gut feeling and election year politics than by any evidence and honest analysis. It would be great to have some reliable guidance to lead us out of this mess, but what we thought was authoritative guidance failed to see the mess coming and may actually have helped create the mess to begin with. Expert models of finance and the economy led to risk-taking at our largest financial firms and failed to warn leading economic policymakers that doom lurked in the housing market. Because our experts' way of looking at the economy left them blind to the crisis that was building, we were unprepared to deal with the crisis. A few weeks after Lehman Brothers went bust, former Fed Chairman Alan Greenspan, the steward of our economy, during the 20 years that culminated in the housing bubble, told our colleagues on the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee that his reaction to the financial crisis was shocked disbelief. He had found a flaw, as he put it, in the model that he perceived to be the critical functioning structure that defines how the world works. Greenspan's fallen model of the market shares many of the assumptions with the model that's favored today, from academia to the world's central banks. The macroeconomic model is called the dynamic stochastic general equilibrium model, mercifully called DSGE for short. According to the model's most devoted acolytes, the model's insights rival the perfect knowledge that Paul described in the first letter to the Corinthians. But unlike the knowledge that Paul described, DSGE's insights are supposedly available to us in the here and now. That overstates the case some, but if politicians can't exaggerate, who can? To be fair, DSGE and similar macroeconomic models were conceived as theorist tools, but why then do we continue to rely upon them for so many critical decisions, so much practical policy advice? And what has caused them to become and to stay so firmly entrenched? And finally, the most important question of all, how do we get out of the mess we're in? What economic models, what tools are at our disposal to give us useful advice to deal with our urgent economic problems? If this approach to economics is useless for the purposes of advising policymakers to lead to better economic outcomes, what are we getting out of the economic research we fund through NSF? Besides raising these questions about the dominant model, we plan to have a look at the competition. What kinds of alternative models exist, and do we need to generate more still? Should we be using a variety of models in concert rather than relying on only one model or one kind of model, much the way meteorologists use a variety of models? Should the federal government use its funding of economic science to encourage the development of those alternative approaches? We do have a very distinguished panel today to help us consider these issues. Dr. Robert Solow will tell us what is in the DSGE model, where it parts from the realities of the world, and what kind of advice it tends to deliver. Dr. Solow very modestly is not wearing today for this hearing his Nobel medallion. Dr. Sidney Winter will talk about the economic realities that DSGE and its macroeconomic cousins fail to take into account and about how to look for policy advice when there are important features of the economy that don't lend themselves to modeling. Dr. Scott Page will provide a glimpse of a new form of model that advanced computing power has made possible, the agent-based model, and make a case for the use of many and varied models. Dr. David Collander will explain why DSGE has achieved such a monopoly and outline a plan designed to open the floor to broader spectrum of ideas. And Dr. V.V. Chari will state that while DSGE models are definitely capable of improvement, many of the criticisms leveled against them are inaccurate, and in any case, there is no other game in town. And I note that Dr. Chari is the minority witness and is a very useful addition to this panel today. I yield back my time. Actually, I had no time to yield back, and I now recognize the ranking member, Dr. Brown, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me welcome the witnesses today, and I greatly appreciate y'all being here with us. Today's hearing on macroeconomic modeling continues this committee's work on the role of science in economics. Not surprisingly, several of the topics addressed at our previous two hearings are also relevant today as we discuss macroeconomic modeling. Understanding the purpose and limitations of models is just as important in macroeconomic modeling models as it is in financial risk modeling. In general, modeling is also a theme this committee has addressed several times in the past, whether it is in regard to climate change, chemical exposures, pandemics, determining spacecraft survivability, or attempting to value complex financial instruments. Models are only as good as the data and assumptions that go into them. Ultimately, decisions have to be made based on a number of variables, which should include scientific models, but certainly not exclusively. As a witness, as a previous hearing stated, quote, science describes, it does not prescribe, unquote. No model will ever relieve a banker, trader, risk manager, or policymaker of the responsibility of making difficult decisions. This committee struggles enough with the complexities of modeling, risk assessment, and risk management regarding the physical sciences. Attempting to adapt these concepts to economics is even more complex. Despite the attempts of many to develop a scientific panacea for informing economic decisions, models are only a tool employed by decision makers and economists. They add another layer of insight, but they are not crystal balls. Appreciating this complexity and understanding the limitation and intended purpose of economic models is just as important as what the models tell us. We have an esteemed panel of witnesses here today who will discuss the appropriate roles and limitations of models, such as the dynamic stochastic general equilibrium DSG model. Mr. Chairman, maybe they'll explain why they picked such a name, but I look forward to y'all's testimony, and I yield back the balance of my time. Thank you.
The reason I said it out loud was that we would all be forgiven of that and could all just say DSGE going forward. I now ask unanimous consent that all additional opening statements submitted by members will be included in the record. Without objection, so ordered. It is now my pleasure to introduce our witnesses. Dr. Robert Solow is Institute Professor Emeritus at MIT, where he's been a professor of economics since 1949, and is currently Foundation Scholar at the Russell Sage Foundation, as well as the President of the Cornott Center for Economic Studies. I had more about you, sir. Dr. Solow did receive the Nobel Prize for Economics, as I mentioned earlier, in 1987, the National Medal of Sciences in 1999. He was a member of the National Academy of Science. Dr. Solow was the chairman of the board of the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston for 3 years. Earlier in his career, he served as the senior economist on the Council of Economic Advisors during President Kennedy's administration. Dr. Sidney Winter is the Deloitte and Touche Professor of Management Emeritus at the Wharton School of the University of Pennsylvania before joining Wharton in 1933. He served for 4 years as Chief Economist of the U.S. General Accounting Office, now called the Government Accountability Office, our friends, the GAO, in Washington. He taught for more than two decades in the economics departments of Yale University and the University of Michigan. Dr. Scott Page is the Leonard Hurwitz Collegiate Professor of Complex Systems, Political Science, and Economics at the University of Michigan, and an external faculty member of the Santa Fe Institute. Dr. Page, you might want to come up with a shorter way to describe your job, just like DSGE is so handy. He is the author of three books and more than 50 scientific research papers and has won awards for teaching and service at four major universities. Dr. V.V. Chari is the Paul W. Frenzel Land-Grant Professor of Liberal Arts, Professor of Economics, and Founding Director of the Heller-Hurwitz Institute at the University of Minnesota. He has served the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis, for which he now consults as a senior research officer and economic advisor. He has been elected fellow of the Econometric Society. And then finally, Dr. David Kolander has been the Christian A. Johnson Distinguished Professor of Economics at Middlebury College since 1982. He has authored, co-authored, or edited more than 40 books and 150 articles on a wide range of topics. His books include a Principles of Macroeconomics text and Intermediate Macro text. He is the former president of the History of Economic Thought Society. Our witnesses should know that you each have 5 minutes for your spoken testimony. Your written testimony will be included in the record of the hearing. When you've completed your spoken testimony, we will begin with questions. Each member of will have 5 minutes to question. It is the practice of the subcommittee, since this is an Investigations and Oversight Subcommittee, to take testimony under oath. It does seem very unlikely that there would be any perjury prosecutions coming out of today's hearing. The prosecutor, the U.S. attorney, would have to prove that you knew the truth and consciously deviated from it. Do any of you have any objection to taking an oath? The record should reflect that all the witnesses indicated that they had no objection. You also have the right to be represented by counsel. Do any of you have counsel here? Surprisingly enough, the record should reflect that none of the witnesses or all the witnesses indicated they did not have counsel. Please now stand and raise your right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth and nothing but the truth? The record should reflect that all the witnesses did take the oath. We will now start with Dr. Robert Solow. Dr. Solow, you are recognized for 5 minutes. I think you may need to turn on is your microphone on?
Well, I started by thanking you and Dr. Brown for inviting me to this hearing. It's a law to be discussing an abstract question like how the macroeconomy works under circumstances like this, but it's pretty urgent. Here we are near the bottom, as the chairman said, of a deep and prolonged recession, and the immediate future is very uncertain. We're in desperate need of jobs, and the approach to macroeconomics that dominates the elite universities of the country and many central banks and other influential policy circles, that approach seems to have essentially nothing to say about the problem. It doesn't offer any guidance or insight, and it really seems to have nothing useful to say. And my goal in the next few minutes is to try to explain why it has failed and is sort of intrinsically bound to fail. But before I go on, there's something preliminary that I want to make clear. I am generally a quite traditional mainstream economist. I think that the body of economic analysis that we've built up over the years and teach to our students is pretty good. There's no need to overturn it in any wholesale way, and there's no acceptable suggestions for doing that. It goes without saying that there are big gaps in our understanding of the economy, and there are plenty of things we know that ain't true. That's almost inevitable. The national economy is a fearfully complex thing, and it's changing all the time, so there's no chance that anyone is ever going to get it right once and for all. So it's all the more important to catch foolishness when you see it. when it comes to things as important as macroeconomics, I think that every proposition has to pass a smell test. Does it really make sense? And I don't think that the currently popular DSGE models, I can say dynamic stochastic general equilibrium without a lapse, I don't think that those models pass the smell test. They take it for granted that the whole economy can be thought of as if it were a single consistent person or dynasty carrying out a rationally designed long-term plan, occasionally disturbed by unexpected shocks, but adapting to them in a rational, consistent way. I don't think that that picture passes the smell test. And the protagonists of this idea make a claim to respectability by asserting that it's founded on what we know about microeconomic behavior, but I really think that this claim is generally phony. The advocates believe what they say, there's no doubt, but they seem to have stopped sniffing or to have lost their sense of smell altogether. So the most economists are willing to believe that individual agents, consumers, investors, borrowers, lenders, workers, employers, all make their decisions so as to do roughly the best that they can for themselves, given their possibilities and their information. They don't always behave in that fairly rational way, and systematic deviations are well worth studying. But it's not a bad first approximation in many cases. The DSGE model populates its simplified economy with exactly one single combined worker, owner, consumer, everything else, who plans ahead carefully, lives forever. And one important consequence of this representative agent assumption is that there are no conflicts of interest, no incompatible expectations, no deceptions. This all-purpose decision maker essentially runs the economy according to its own preferences. Not directly, of course. The economy has to operate through generally well-behaved markets and prices, under pressure from skeptics and from the need to deal with actual data. DSGE modelers have worked hard to allow for various market frictions and imperfections like rigid prices and wages, asymmetries of information, time lags, and so on. This is all to the good, and they have done very good work. But the basic story always treats the whole economy as if it were like a person trying consciously and rationally to do the best it can on behalf of the representative agent given its circumstances. This cannot be an adequate description of a national economy, which is pretty conspicuously not pursuing a consistent goal. A thoughtful person faced with that economic policy based on that kind of idea might reasonably wonder what planet he or she is on. Most obvious example is that the DSGE story has no real room for unemployment of the kind we see most of the time, and especially now. Unemployment that's pure waste. There are competent workers willing to work at the prevailing wage or even a bit less, but the potential job is stymied by a market failure. The economy is simply unable to organize a win-win situation that's apparently there for the taking. This sort of outcome is incompatible with the notion that the economy is in rational pursuit of an intelligible goal. The only way that DSGE and related models can cope with unemployment is to make it somehow voluntary, a choice of current leisure, or a desire to retain flexibility for the future, or something like that. But that's exactly the sort of explanation that does not pass the smell test. To the extent that the observed economy is actually doing the best it can, given the circumstances, it is already adapting optimally to whatever expected or unexpected disturbances come along. It cannot do better. It follows that conscious public policy can only make things worse. If the government has better information than the representative agent has, then all the government has to do is to make the information public. If prices are imperfectly flexible, then the government can make them more flexible by attacking monopolies and weakening unions. And actually, even that proposition is dubious on its own. The point that I'm making is that the DSGE model has nothing useful to say about anti-recession policy because it has built into its essentially implausible assumption the conclusion that there is nothing for macroeconomic policy to do. I think we've just seen how untrue that is for an economy attached to a highly leveraged, weakly regulated financial system, as the chairman pointed out, but I think it was just as visibly false in earlier recessions and in episodes of inflationary overheating that followed quite different patterns. There are other traditions in macroeconomics that provide better ways to do macroeconomics, and I hope we will get a chance to talk about that soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Solo. Dr. Winter, you are recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, this hearing explores some fundamental and relatively neglected questions related to the recent financial crisis, and I'm pleased and honored to be asked to participate. And I'm honored to be following Bob Solo in this panel because Bob was once my college honors examiner and not long after that my boss, but that was a long time ago. As you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, I moved to the management department at the Wharton School of the University of Pennsylvania after previously having spent 2 decades teaching microeconomic theory at the PhD level. One of the reasons that I shifted to a managed department is that it offered me a more supportive environment for my research, which is more concerned than is the economics discipline with the realities of business behavior and of organizational behavior generally. The concern of this hearing, the shortcomings of the DSGE model, represents the tip of a very large iceberg, an iceberg which comprises by far the greatest proportion of model building and theorizing in the discipline, both macroeconomic and microeconomic. A distinctive feature of economics among the sciences is the degree to which most economists, especially most theoretical economists, are oblivious to behavioral realities at the levels of the fundamental units of the complex system that they study, the business firms and households. Although many economists defy that description, they remain few compared to the mainstream and do not get much attention or carry much weight. I was asked to discuss what is left out of the DSGE model. All theories must, of course, leave out almost everything, since the point of theory is to simplify reality in a way that tells the truth while not aspiring to tell the whole truth. But DSGE is an extreme example of the tendency to analyze hyper-stylized versions of economic problems, thereby denying or suppressing quite observable and verifiable realities. If improving the model is the problem, the challenge is to identify specific causal mechanisms in reality that should be in the model but are now excluded. However, in my view, improving the model is not the only thing that deserves attention. We should really be talking about how to organize ourselves to meet the real needs for economic policy guidance, initially leaving open the questions about models and empirical inquiry. I attempt 3 things in the remainder of my time. First, I mention of a piece of economic reality that was fundamental to the recent financial crisis but was not reflected in the DSGE model or any macroeconomic model I know of. Second, I will suggest the difficulties and prospects of adding this piece to the prevailing models. And third, I will expand on the need to extend the quest for policy advice beyond models and their improvement. The piece of reality I referred to is the process by which the residential mortgage business in the United States evolved into a system where nobody really cared whether the loans were going to be repaid. This meant, as you know, not attending carefully to the creditworthiness of borrowers and not seriously appraising the collateral. These practices developed slowly out of familiar mechanisms of self-interest with attendant thoughtful advocacy, until in the end, lenders in a traditional sense with traditional lender incentives had gone almost extinct as an economic species. I review this story in my written testimony. This is a pretty shocking thing in an economy in which self-interest is regarded as a fundamental and generally constructive guiding force. It may be particularly shocking to economic theorists because it beautifully illustrates a type of behavioral reality that most theorists tend to deny, since it seems sharply at odds with conventional oversimplified images of economic rationality. What? Lenders didn't care about loan repayment? Most theorists would be so sure that couldn't happen that they wouldn't bother to check. While there were other contributing factors, If you ask what distinguished this event from other economic crises, it becomes clear that residential mortgages and the business practices related to them were central to this crisis and to where the bailout money went. Without the mortgage-related practices, there might still have been a crisis at some point, but it would not have been much like the financial crisis of 2008, and it might have been a lot less severe. So was this episode something that macroeconomic theory could or should make room for? These are all major macroeconomic events, and they have a clear basis in long-sustained patterns of economic behavior among private sector actors. So there might be a presumption that the causal mechanisms do belong in the model. Yet it is hard to imagine that much of the story of mortgage market evolution is eligible for inclusion in macroeconomic theory as we conventionally understand it. The mortgage market is by itself far more complex than the DSGE model represents the whole economy to be. We could at least have a richer collection of partial models to inform us, and we need in particular models based on business practice, an idea that does not appear in any mainstream economic theory text that I know about. Other keywords to look for would include habit, organizational routines, organizational capabilities, business systems, business processes. They are all very much a part of the reality, and they can produce social outcomes very different from those anticipated in standard theory, and they are all absent from the textbooks. This is probably because they are all in some ways at odds with the theorist's assumption that businesses reliably get the right answer to the problems that they faced. Finally, I return to my suggestion that we may need to look beyond the models and the theories to find the kinds of adjustments that are needed and appropriate given the very large social stakes in macroeconomic problems. New research initiatives are needed in the regulatory agencies as well as in academe. Most fundamentally, we need to make sure that adequate intellectual resources are applied to the task of understanding what is happening in the economy as opposed to what is happening in the models. Those seeking that understanding must draw on the valuable body of knowledge that mainstream economics has accumulated, but also on much broader sources. Historical perspective is particularly important. In the domain of modeling, we need more models that seek to capture systematic behavioral tendencies as they are, and then assess the implied outcomes in terms of the service to private and social interests, rather than committing fully to the right answer framework from the very start. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Winter. Dr. Page, you recognize for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for the committee for this opportunity to come and speak. As mentioned, I'm a professor of complex systems at the University of Michigan and the Sanef Institute. Complex systems is probably unfamiliar to many of you, so I'm going to begin with a simple definition, if I may. Complex systems consist of diverse, connected, interdependent, and adaptive actors who collectively produce phenomena that are difficult to explain or predict. So given this definition, an economy, traffic on the beltway, or even the stuff that goes on inside the beltway, right, is going to be classified as complex. In my comments today, I want to describe the benefits of having a variety of models when trying to understand a complex system. And then I'm going to show how complex systems models themselves have an ability to generate insights that are going to be of interest to this committee, including the pace of innovation and market crashes. So let me talk for a minute about the success of models as predictors. Models have proven almost, as Dr. Brown mentioned, almost unbelievably accurate in predicting some physical phenomena, such as the patterns in which planets orbit the sun. Yet, as we all know, models have proven less adept at predicting the economy. And that's because the economy is complex. The solar system is complicated. It's got lots of connected parts. But those parts aren't very diverse, right? They're little orbs, and they don't adapt. And because of that, it's predictable. So if you take something like a complex system, a single model can only cast so much light. Hence, we need multiple models. And this is an idea that goes back to Aristotle, who asserted that a multitude is a better judge than any individual. Now, that's not just an intuition. That's something that we can actually formalize. So in my own work, I've written some stuff that basically says, if I have a crowd of models and take the average of those predictions, then you can prove the following, that the crowd of models' accuracy is going to equal the average model's accuracy plus the model diversity. So this mathematical identity that I've framed here verbally shows the benefits of combining models. What you want is you want a lot of models, and you want those models to be diverse. But that's not to say that a group of models is accurately going to forecast the economy. It probably won't. The economy is too complex. But we can widen our lens, and we can use a crowd of models to predict bounds on the likely fluctuations in the economy and to anticipate unintended consequences and riskiness of policy decisions, such as the expanding of use of sophisticated financial instruments, such as credit default swaps. So let me turn to my second point, the particular value of complex systems models to help understand and guide the economy. This goes back to some of the things that Bob and Sid have mentioned. The economy consists of over 300 million people, 30 million organizations, and about 90% of those seek profits, and tens of thousands of government agencies. These actors are diverse, they have diverse beliefs and goals, they adapt as circumstances change, and they don't do so in lockstep. Some people spend, some save, some innovate, some people seek the comfort of routine. It's the aggregated interdependent actions of these millions of actors, people, organizations, and governments, that produce the macroeconomic patterns that we're trying to explain and predict. So how do we model this? The neoclassical approach assumes that individuals and firms make optimal choices subject to constraints on budgets, technology, and time. Actors, be they firms, people, or governments, accurately anticipate the future effects of their actions and the government's actions. And in its simplest form, this model is going to produce a stable equilibrium with balanced growth. Now, modern variants, which Chari will probably talk about in this model, include technological shocks that reverberate throughout the economy. These variants also include frictions, such as wages that are slow to fail. This stickiness exacerbates the depth and length of the echoes caused by the shocks. Now, this neoclassical model, this DSG model, is stark. It assumes no sectors of the economy, no unemployment, no physical geography, no networks of connections, no learning, the agents are always optimizing, and little or no heterogeneity of income, wealth, or behaviors. Further, almost all of the responses by the actors tend to equilibrate the system. So, for example, if you get an increase in demand for housing, this is going to increase the price of housing, therefore causing a reduction in future demand of housing. This is what we call in complex systems a negative feedback. The more you get of something, these negative feedbacks push things back. They tend to stabilize systems, and they lie at the core of neoclassical models. Now, the complexity approach assumes individuals with diverse incomes and abilities who are situated in place and time. These actors don't necessarily maximize profits or utility. Instead, what they do is they follow rules that have survived or succeeded in the marketplace. So if a financial firm with greater leverage, such as Morgan Stanley, is making higher profits, other firms may follow their lead. Now note this effect. More leverage leads to greater leverage. This is a positive feedback. Positive feedbacks create what we call correlated behavior. Hence, systems that contain them can exhibit clustered volatility in large events, like stock market crashes and home mortgage crises. These could be avoided if the agents in the model were capable of predicting the future and realizing they should be optimizing, not following other people. But they're not, and unfortunately, neither are we. So I don't mean to imply that complex systems can predict crashes. They probably can't. But they can provide an alternative lens to enable us to design rules, laws, incentives, and institutions, as well as encourage the development of productive social norms that might reduce the likelihood and severity of financial collapses. Complex systems also are often utilized, are analyzed using computational, what are called agent-based techniques, as was mentioned. These techniques are capable of including sector-level details, financial markets, real estate markets, and service markets. The ability of complex systems models to include realistic detail creates the potential for new insights into causes and rates of innovation. So, for example, from a complex systems perspective, the innovative potential of an economy depends on its building blocks, the ideas, technologies, and basic science that sits out there that people work with. So innovation comes about by combining and recombining those building blocks. Lest I make agent-based models seem like a panacea, I should add a word of warning. A model that contains too much detail can be as perplexing as the real world it was built to explain. Models should only include so much detail as necessary and no more. So it's an open question what necessary detail should be included in models of the economy, but I believe that the financial sector, unemployment, and heterogeneous consumers probably fit the bill. So to sum up, our goal is to understand an economy that's increasing in complexity. The neoclassical approach emphasizes optimization in the face of constraints. The complex systems paradigm emphasizes diversity, networks, interdependencies, positive as well as negative, and adaptation. So let me conclude with my first point. For a non-complex system, we can use single models. We can, for example, just multiply an object's mass by its acceleration and get a really good approximation of force. But if we have a complex system like an economy, no one model will likely work. We need a crowd. We actually need a crowd of diverse models. I thank you for this opportunity to speak to the committee.
Thank you, Dr. Page. Dr. Chari, you are recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's an honor and a privilege to testify before this committee. Let me begin with a disclaimer. Nothing I say here should be construed as reflecting the views of the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis or the Federal Reserve System. I want to make make 3 points in this testimony. The first point is that macroeconomic research is a very big tent which accommodates a very diverse area of perspectives and is open to lots of different ways of thinking about the economy. The second issue that I want to raise is, why did the current generation of so-called DSGE models, and there's not one, there are many, fail to see the crisis coming? And what should macroeconomic research look like going forward in order to forestall future crises? And the third is, what can the public and Congress do to foster the kinds of macroeconomic research that's needed to ensure that we don't have catastrophes like the events of the last couple of years? First, in terms of macroeconomic research, as I said, is a very big tent, accommodates a very diverse set of viewpoints. There's a shared language and a shared methodology, but not necessarily a shared substance in terms of policy issues. This openness and flexibility is best summarized by an aphorism that macroeconomists often use. If you have an interesting and a coherent story to tell, you can do so within a DSGE model. If you cannot, it probably is incoherent. Now, macroeconomic research has changed a lot in the last 25 years, and I want to emphasize the nature of that change, and I believe that much of that change constitutes progress. The state-of-the-art DSGE model in, say, 1982 had a representative agent, no unemployment, no financial factors, no sticky prices and wages, no crises, no role for government. What do the state-of-the-art DSGE models of today look like? They have heterogeneity, all kinds of heterogeneity arising from income fluctuations, unemployment, and the like. They have unemployment. They do have financial factors. They have sticky prices and wages. They have crises, and they have a role for government. Given the limited amount of time, let me talk about financial factors. The best way of thinking about the important developments in theorizing about financial factors is to think about the career and accomplishments of Ben Bernanke. Now, the way I've often heard this statement summarized is, academic macroeconomists who are interested and active in policy routinely write down models with no role for financial factors. Nothing could be further from the truth. Ben devoted his career to developing such models. Was he a bit player, a heterodox person way outside on the sidelines of modern macroeconomics? No, he was chairman of Princeton's economics department. He was right at the center, at the heart of macroeconomic debate and issues and improving models. Second, let me talk about crises. Now, our brothers and sisters in international macroeconomics who study the economies of other countries have, for the last decade or more, been routinely developing DSGE models, quantitative DSGE models with crises. Why? Because they've been studying countries that have been routinely buffeted by these kinds of crises, so it's natural for them to study them. How about role for the government? Kerrigan and Wallace in the late 70s emphasized that deposit insurance, together with government bailouts possibly, creates strong private incentives for excessive risk-taking. And they emphasized the importance of government regulation in order to prevent these incentives for excessive risk-taking from going overboard. So macro models are very different from what they were. They can analyze a wide variety of policies. They are being used, particularly by central banks, to guide monetary policy. They have been used in policy circles to analyze questions of fundamental tax reform, social security reform, and I believe they can and should be used for other policies and questions. But all is not fine and dandy. Clearly, this class of models failed to see the crisis coming. Why? I offer three reasons. First, any model has got to be disciplined by historical data. That's a necessity. Now, modelers of the US economy naturally tend to focus on the experience of the last 60 years, particularly of the US. What has the experience of the last 60 years been? Well, relative especially to other countries, it's been remarkably stable, except for the recent crisis. And so in that sense, those kinds of models naturally tended to de-emphasize these kinds of financial crises. The sad thing about this is that, as I said, the people in international macro writing down models, quantitative DSGE models of crises. What should we have done? We should have incorporated their insights. Why did we not? It's natural. Whenever I read a paper about, say, Argentina, I'm tempted to say, oh, well, that's Argentina. We're the US. It can't happen here. What we have learned is it can happen here, and it's clear going forward that we need to incorporate those kinds of insights. It's clear going forward we need to incorporate the insights from the banking and deposit insurance literature on incentives to take on excessive risk. Those are elements that were thought unimportant. They clearly are not unimportant. They are within our toolkit and can be used. Final issue, what, if anything at all, can the public and Congress do about this? It's useful to put some numbers on the table here. NSF funding for economics overall is roughly $27 million. $2.6 million of that goes to the PSID, a very worthwhile activity. About 10% of the remainder goes to fund, in my judgment, in my estimation, macroeconomic research. So we're talking about $2.5 million. Now, compare $2.5 million with the NSF's budget of roughly $7 billion and an overall basic research budget for the federal government of the order of about $30 billion. And so we're talking about less than peanuts. We're talking about a tiny amount of money. Now, would investing additional resources in macroeconomic research of the kind that's being practiced in the best universities and the best research departments across the nation add substantially to our welfare? In my judgment, yes. All we have to do is reduce the probability of the next crisis by 0.01%. And if we quadrupled the amount of resources to NSF's macroeconomics research program, it would pay for itself tenfold. That's the kind of return that we're talking about. Now, can that return be realized? Not for sure. No one can offer guarantees, but I think that the odds are that we've got a bunch of really smart people, capable people, who are open to diverse ideas. They can do it. So let me conclude by trying to summarize the three basic messages. First is a message to critics. These are not your father's models. These models are very different from the descriptions that critics often offer of these kinds of models. And so it's not helpful to advance the debate on the future of modern macro by caricaturing models from a generation ago. Message to my fellow researchers, yes, the United States is not Argentina, but we have a lot to learn from the experiences of other countries. Third, the message to public and Congress is that macroeconomic research of the kind that's being practiced at leading departments offers a very gigantic bang for the buck. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chaudhry. Dr. Colander, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to testify. I'm known in the economics profession as the economics court jester. Because I'm the person who says what everyone knows, but everyone knows better than to say in polite company. As a court jester, I see it appropriate to start my testimony with a well-known joke, a variation of a well-known joke. It begins with a congressman walking home late at night. He notices an economist searching under the lamppost for his keys. Recognizing that the economist is a potential voter, he stops to help. After searching a while without luck, he asks the economist where he lost his keys. The economist points over into the dark abyss. The congressman asks incredulously, "Then why the heck are you searching here?" To which the economist responds, "This is where the light is." That well-known joke is told by critics of economists a lot because it captures economists' tendency to be highly mathematical and technical in their research. On the surface, searching where the light is clearly a stupid strategy. The obvious place to search is where you've lost the keys. However, that, in my view, is the wrong lesson to take from this joke. I would argue that for scientific research, the searching where the light is strategy is far from stupid. Where else but in the light can you reasonably search to find your key or to figure out in a scientific way what the system is? What is stupid? If the person who's there searching thinks he's going to find the keys under the lamppost. Searching where the light is only makes good sense if the search is not to find the keys, that is to come up with practical policy recommendations based directly on models, but rather to expand theoretical knowledge, to understand the topography of the illuminated land and how that lighted topography relates to the topography of the dark, in the dark where the keys were lost. Most top economic theorists I talk to know that it is stupid to directly search for policy keys in the light. Then why do they often let people assume that's what they're doing? Because they believe that if they didn't appear to be doing so, they wouldn't get funding. The reality is that funders of economic research, such as NSF, all too often want immediate policy answers from abstract scientific models. Researchers respond to incentives, and if the researcher's livelihood is dependent on drawing policy conclusions from abstract formal models, they will do it. So if the economist had answered the congressman honestly, he would have told him, I'm searching for the keys here because that's where you're funding me to search. Keynes once said that policymakers are the slaves of some defunct economist. Economists like that story, by the way. To make the story complete, however, what he should have added is that in turn, economists are the slaves of some defunct policymaker who established a funding system for research. The incentives inherent in that funding system play a central role in the kind of research that gets done. The reason I'm testifying here is I believe NSF can take the lead in changing the institutional incentive structure by implementing two structural changes in NSF program funding economics, and I think that these will change economists' incentives. The first proposal involves making diversity of the reviewer pool an explicit goal of reviewing process of NSF grants in social sciences. This would involve consciously including what are dissenting economists as part of the peer reviewing pool, as well as reviewers outside of economics, such as physicists, mathematicians, statisticians, and individuals from business and government who have real-world experience. They could put some sense of what Professor Solo said, does it pass the smell test? Such a broader peer review process would likely encourage research on a much broader range of models, promoting more creative work and providing that common sense feedback from the real world that you need to figure out whether the topography of the models fits the topography of the land that you're trying to search for in the dark. The second proposal involves increasing the number of researchers trained in relating models to the real world as opposed to just producing models. This can be done by explicitly providing some research grants to interpret rather than develop models. In a sense, what I'm suggesting is an applied science division of the National Science Foundation's economics component. This division would fund work on analyzing which of the many models are there being developed are appropriate for the real world. The applied science work would involve a quite different set of skills than the standard scientific economics research requires. It would require researchers to have a solid consumer's knowledge of economic theory and econometrics, but not necessarily a producer's knowledge of that. You often find that people can be fantastic at producing models, are not very good at interpreting them and relating them to the real world. And you can have more specialization than what we have. In addition, it would require a knowledge of institutions, methodology, and previous literature, as well as a sensibility of how the system works. And I think, you know, there are definitely economists who have that. Ben Bernanke, I think, does. Alan Blinder. But interestingly, when they were at Princeton, they weren't the one teaching macro theory. And when I talked to students there, when I taught there, they said, oh, we wouldn't take it from him. That wouldn't prepare us to write articles. So they were taught undergraduates as opposed to the graduates. And that, to me, is crazy. The skills involved in interpreting models are the skills that are currently not taught in graduate economic programs. By providing grants for interpretive work, the NSF would encourage the development of a group of economists who specialize in interpreting models and applying models to the real world, making it less likely that fiascos like the financial crisis would occur. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Colander. I now recognize Dr. Brown for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I ask unanimous consent that Ms. Biggert, a member of the full committee, participate in this subcommittee as if she were a member of this subcommittee.
And my colleague on the Financial Services Committee. Without objection, that is so ordered. Begin with questions, the first round of questions, and I now recognize myself for 5 minutes. Dr. Chari, you testified that 30 years ago the models assumed no government action could improve things, and that was no longer the assumption, but there seems to be some disagreement among the panel about the extent to which policy can improve things. My own experience in the financial crisis as a policymaker has been very much with a narrow, micro kind of point of view. When I was first elected to Congress in 2003, the advice I got was that most members of the House, unlike the Senate, where they can hold forth on all matters, most members of the House labored in obscurity, and I should pick some technical issue no one cared about or was paying any attention to. I would probably never be heard from again, but if I had picked an issue that there was no one from my party, from my point of view, who had already claimed that issue, I would be doing useful work. That the issue I picked was mortgage lending. My experience in dealing with mortgage lending was that the loans, the individual loans, were horrific. Dr. Solo talked about the assumptions that there were no conflicts of interest and no lack of information, no lack of knowledge, and middle-class homeowners, and really subprime mortgage lending was not to purchase homes, it was people who owned homes and needed to borrow money. There were refinances, overwhelmingly refinances. They were handed a sheaf of documents, small print, written by the bank's lawyer, by someone else's lawyer, not by their lawyer. And they were getting advice from a mortgage broker who was actually being paid by the lender in addition to what they're being paid by the borrower, and were getting paid more by the lender the worse the loans were for the borrower. And the borrowers, the homeowners, were relying upon that advice and being told that this is very complicated. I will help you through this. I'm a mortgage professional. Almost everything I said should be changed met with the argument, oh, that will result in unintended consequences. And I would say, what kind of unintended consequences? Well, we don't know. That's the point. They're unintended. It kind of became an epistemological test. You know, how could you possibly do anything without knowing that there would not be unintended consequences? Do all of you agree that the models do now assume that there is government action, that government action can help, and how do we overcome the concern about unintended consequences? God only knows what they are. Any of you, Dr. Chari, since you were the one who said 30 years ago there has been a change from your father's economic models?
Sure. Here's one way of illustrating the nature of that change. Earlier this month, the Society for Economic Dynamics, a hotbed of DSG-style modeling, held its meetings. About 400 papers were presented. I flipped through the program. About 50 of those papers dealt with policy in macroeconomic models. Guess what? In none of the 50 was the best role for the government to get out of the way and stay out of the way. In every one of those 50 papers, every one of them analyzed, ranging from monetary policy to fiscal policy to innovation, on all across the line, they all had a role for policy. In terms of sort of the thinking through the mortgage market, I think it's really important to understand that if you look at the people who held the debt issued by major financial intermediaries, ex post, that is now, after all these events, they have suffered very small losses, primarily because of various bailout programs. These debts that were issued by major financial intermediaries were backed in substantial part by subprime and other kinds of mortgages. It is rational in a world like that that the people who issue subprime mortgages will pay very little attention to the risk characteristics of the borrowers. I'm not saying that's the only factor, but that's an important factor. Understanding the importance of that factor has obvious implications for the nature of financial regulation going forward. And that's the kind of insight that comes out of thinking through a model in which even if everybody counterfactually behaves very rationally, you can create very perverse incentives, you can create very bad outcomes, and you can create an important role for government policy.
Any of the others want to address the role of government under any of these models, or whether the extent to which the models assume that government can play a useful role? Dr. Solo, you certainly touched upon it, as did you, Dr. Winter. Dr. Solo?
Yes, thank you. I have a lot of empathy for Dr. Chary and what he is trying to explain. This is very difficult to do. It's easy to say you should include this aspect of reality, you should include that aspect of reality. To try to do it in a logically tight way is extremely difficult. But when he says that the more recent vintages of DSGE models have a role for government or allow for unemployment, then I think that's really a little misleading in the sense that if you were to look closely at a DSGE model with unemployment and ask how does unemployment happen and what does it mean, it wouldn't be the kind of unemployment that you see in your district, for instance. It wouldn't be the case where there are workers who are unemployed workers competent to do a job because they did it 6 months ago or a year ago, prepared to work for a little less than the going wage, and no one will employ them because there is no market available for their output. Instead, if you read the pages on unemployment in a DSGE model, it's full of explaining little glitches in the labor market, little inefficiencies here and there. And there's a tendency to underestimate the cost. Similarly, with the role of government, I said those models have lots of room for government. What the government should do is try to make the world more like the neat model by eliminating inflexibilities and rigidities and elements of imperfection and whatnot. The notion that the government might, when there is unemployment and excess capacity, because there is not enough demand for goods and services to employ the whole economy at a reasonable level, that the government should try to find ways to fill that gap, that doesn't appear even in recent vintage DSGE models, because there is no gap. There's not a gap of that kind.
Thank you, Dr. Solo. Dr. Winter, do you feel moved to
Yes, I would like to just comment briefly on what Dr. Chary said. I think in the attempt to understand what happened in the financial crisis, and we should recognize that there are different lines of explanation for the behaviors we see up and down the system, and in Wall Street in particular. Enormous losses were inflicted on Wall Street firms, and enormous personal losses on some Wall Street players. And there's a question of whether that happened because they didn't understand the system that they had participated in creating, or whether they were in some more rational way responding to the incentives of the system that presented themselves. So that, in fact, is, I think, an important research question. You know, what exactly was the basis for the kinds of decisions that created these enormous financial vulnerabilities? And there are voices out there, which I consider to be credible voices, that say basically Wall Street confused itself in the end and created a system which it in turn did not understand at all. Now, I don't know what the right answer is, but it's a very important question. And what I would argue for in the domain of economic research is that we try to do better at resolving some of those questions on a factual basis when they turn up. There's a whole list of questions like that about the financial crisis, which could be investigated with high academic standards and systematically would tell us a lot about how the system failed us.
Dr. Page.
Yeah, I guess one quick comment, and this gets to this, I think some of the stuff David had said and also Chari as well, is that I agree that these DSG models are powerful models, and they've definitely changed over the last 20, 30 years, but there's this fundamental question of how do we think of the economy? So if I give you one word to describe the economy and you could choose between equilibrium or complex, you'd probably vote complex, right? But yet, where the streetlight is, as David was saying, is and what where we've built up all this knowledge, is in these equilibrium models. Now, there's been attempts, and I think they've been extremely successful, to introduce, you know, volatility. Like, you know, so there's this notion that now there's a shock to the equilibrium, and then because of frictions and heterogeneities, that shock echoes through the system, creating these complex patterns. But this equilibrium mindset, I think, can be complemented by a mindset that instead thinks of the economy as something we're probably never going to understand, but we will see that different sets of policies create different types of incentives, creating certain types of positive and negative feedback. So we did see this giant rush. When you see, if you're just monitoring the economy and you don't think it's perfectly working, and you suddenly see this huge rise in refinancing, a little bell should go off and you should say, let's think through the repercussions of this thing. And what the finance people would have told you is they would have said, look, we're bundling all this risk, it's all gonna be fine. And they'd have said, looking back at you know, past data, this bundling's gonna work. But then you realize you're placing a lot of faith on a particular assumption about bundling that in fact didn't hold true, right? So I think that there's a fundamental question of this notion between do we think of the economy as in equilibrium, and that's, and if you do, then you're imposing a lot of logical coherence, and if you do want that logical coherence, then you're sort of stuck with something like DSGE. There's an alternative approach which is based more on sort of complexity theory, which is not as advanced, which thinks of the economy constantly in flux. And one of the things that's been great about the NSF, I should say, is they've funded a lot of this very exploratory research into complex systems, right, to try and create alternative models of the economy.
We have now gloriously exceeded my time, but Dr. Colander, you appear to be longing to address this question as well.
You know, I'd like to reiterate, you know, what Scott just said, that it really is a point. DSGE models are wonderful, and you can expand them and everything else. They're impressive. But they're one particular point of equilibrium that you're looking at. Then you're relating it to this world out there, which is extraordinarily complicated, which has this complexity, this diversity going on. And yes, you can squeeze and push these DSGE models to make them to explain things, but it's like telling people here, yes, we can get a little roughness in the topography when there's actually a gigantic cliff, or there might be. You need a variety of other models. Now, I'm not saying I know what other models are there. And the emphasis is that one needs a lot of diversity within mainstream macroeconomics. And I consider myself a mainstream macroeconomist, too. But, you know, within that sense, everyone knew, and I think Dr. Cherry has written, you have to start with a DSGE as your foundation. So you have to start from this point and then move out, as opposed to allowing you to search the entire lighted area. And that just hasn't happened. And that, I think, is what Dr. Solo is saying. There's nothing wrong with DSGE models, but there's a lot of topography out there, and we need more of that diversity. And somehow, within the way academia works, it has not allowed that to happen. And that, I think, is sad.
My time has expired, and I apologize to the other members of the committee. Now, we'll try to be reasonably lenient on others' time as well. Dr. Brown's recognized for 5 minutes.
Ms. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent that we let Ms. Bigger go out of order.
Without objection.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Brown. I had to come to this committee because Dr. Solo was here, and I just wanted to say that he is my hero. I have been a longtime member of the Science Committee and a strong proponent of research and development. And so I've frequently, probably very frequently, reminded my colleagues of the importance of research and development in the scientific and technology technological investments in the future of our economic competitiveness and security. So one of the ways that I've done this is always to remind them that science-driven technologies accounted for more than 50% of the growth of the U.S. economy in the last half century, and this was a quote that I always used from Dr. Solow, so I really appreciate being there. And all of you, this has been a very interesting discussion. So maybe just, and I hope I'm not straying off of the subject too much, but I'd like to ask Dr. Solow about the factors that you see contributing to the U.S. growth in the first half of the century, and do you believe that scientific and technological investments will continue to contribute at the same level now that we are in the another century?
Thank you. I don't know how a hero is supposed to respond. I just think before I taught at MIT, I was a technical sergeant in the U.S. Army. And if you just call me Sarge, I'll settle for that. It's the way I spent my youth. I do think that science and technology, first of all, let me say, I don't believe that the current crisis and the long recession will fundamentally impair the long-run growth potential of the U.S. economy, although it's going to take a long time to shake off those effects. But they remain there because, just as you said, the basic sources of those of that growth are in innovation of various kinds. What I think may have changed for the longer run is where in the economy that innovation takes place. We may have suffered from an excessive innovation in the financial services sector of the economy. I love Paul Volcker's remark that the best financial engineering innovation of all was the ATM machine. But I think, for instance, that we need, and the committee possibly ought to think, that if from now on, I suspect to be true, that the weight of the service sector in our economy is permanently bigger than it was in the first half of the 20th century, or even in the second half of the 20th century, what does that say for the character of innovation that can affect the economy? I used to tell students and others that services are just like goods, the only difference being you can't inventory a service. I can't get three haircuts so that I don't have to go back again. But there may be differences in the way, in the kinds of science, and the kinds of innovation that generate productivity in the service sector. There may be differences in the reception that service sector firms can give to technological innovation. And I think that's a good subject for the Committee on Science and Technology to pursue. I have no doubt that those potentialities for long-run growth of productivity are still there. During the buildup of the great stock of computers in the U.S., most of those computers were being bought in the service sector, in retail and wholesale trade, in financial services, and elsewhere. And some service sectors exhibit very rapid growth in productivity. But that's the kind of long-run change in the economy that may affect the role of science and technology. But that role remains fundamental for growth, that it's the generator of long-term growth, I think is undoubtedly still true. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Sarge. now I have to return to the financial services where there's another hearing going on that I'm due to be there. Thank you very much. And thank you again for your indulgence.
Thank you, Ms. Biggert. I now recognize Ms. Dalkemper for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for your testimony today. It's a fascinating subject as we move forward. I'm a new member of Congress, so it's been a truly a fascinating time to join this wonderful body, and I appreciate all of your expertise. I wanted to ask you, I come from northwestern Pennsylvania, so an area actually that's been suffering economically for a long time. But the nation's current number of long-term unemployed is estimated 6.8 million jobless, certainly a number that we've never seen before. So what do macroeconomics or any field or subfield have to say about the effects of the economy of this extended unemployment, of extending unemployment benefits for these people versus just simply letting them fall off the rolls? And I don't know who might like to address that. Anybody particular? Dr. Winter? Or no, I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe Dr. Chari, who would like to? Whoever would like to.
Since you're from northwestern Pennsylvania and I received my PhD in economics from Carnegie Mellon, I suppose I should be the person to try and help out. Let me just say one thing before I start. Professor Solow is not just a hero to Representative Bigger. He's a hero to all macroeconomists, modern or otherwise. So the kinds of models of unemployment that people have written down, most notably kinds of models that Mortensen and Dale Mortensen at Northwestern and Chris Pissarides at the London School of Economics have written down, and a whole bunch of other people have written down, emphasize the key trade-off. The trade-off is that we don't have very good insurance markets to protect people when they do get unemployed, and so therefore there's a role for government policy in providing unemployment compensation because those markets are missing. The trade-off is that providing unemployment benefits does tend to discourage people from looking as intensively for jobs. That's one effect. Second effect, which I think research has demonstrated is much more important, is that it tends to make them more unwilling to accept jobs when they do come up. And so that's the trade-off. Now, making this decision requires understanding the quantitative assessments of those kinds of trade-offs. Those quantitative assessments suggest that in times of relative prosperity, Congress has sensibly decided to not to extend unemployment benefits for too long. In times of greater difficulty, Congress has done it. So we have models that give us numbers. I don't have them immediately offhand, but we can certainly talk about it, and I can communicate those kinds of numbers. But the ultimate decision about the size of those trade-offs, how important is it to protect people from prolonged periods of economic hardship versus the effect on their own incentives, is something that Congress has to make the difficult decision on. But the guidance that modern macro kinds of models can offer is a sense of the quantitative magnitudes of the trade-offs. Both those effects are present. That's what the research seems to demonstrate fairly unequivocally, and so we need to balance those effects. But I don't have immediately offhand the exact numbers that the latest version, of course, they're going to differ from model to model.
Would anyone else like to address that? Dr. Winter, did you want to? And Dr. Solow, after Dr. Winter. Dr. Winter.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, well, I just want to say again that in that area, there's a lot of rhetoric that goes around in the economics discipline about the causes of unemployment and the role of the incentives provided by unemployment insurance. And unfortunately, I don't think this rhetoric moves forward very much over the years. It could be improved by closer study of these phenomena through research, and that would be a valuable thing to do. But on the face of it, it seems to me that when you have the very dramatic changes in levels of unemployment that we have experienced, and when you have the regional diversity that we have in levels of unemployment, that it's quite implausible that there's somehow fixed considerations of human nature underlying the phenomena that you are looking at. I think the people become unemployed because of circumstances beyond their control to a very large extent. So I think, again, if there's doubt about that, and sometimes one hears comments that suggest there is doubt about it, I think it can be looked into carefully and should be.
Dr. Sola, would you like to comment?
Thank you. I just wanted to add to what Sydney just said, with which I agree, that if we simply look at Northwest Pennsylvania, at your area, there are a lot of long-term unemployed people for a number of reasons, for at least two big reasons, none of which has to do with the matter of refined incentives that are provided to them by the unemployment insurance system. One is that in every recession that follows a financial crisis, there is a tendency for unemployment to be very prolonged, because the blow to business confidence and the blow to the confidence of lenders in the creditworthiness of businesses is such as to make businesses unwilling to make long-term commitments to employment. But secondly, Western Pennsylvania is not an area full of rising industries, so that long-term unemployment, I suspect, has been a problem there that was antecedent to the financial crisis. I think one has to ask, what are, in fact, no simple model is going to do this for you. You have to ask, what are the possibilities for Northwest Pennsylvania or for any other particular region of the country? What are the development possibilities that are there? If there are development possibilities, those are the things to pursue. And in the meantime, I think it's simply a matter of humanity to support the 50-plus-year-old workers who clearly are not laying down on job search because they're getting UI benefits. They're not searching so actively because they know damn well there's nothing there to find. But one ought to focus, A, on the economic development of the region, and B, once that's in hand, or in the head at least, on preparing the labor force of the area for whatever kind of development seems promising. Looking at piddling little incentives, I think, is not going to help us at all.
Well, thank you. That's sort of the sense I get from talking to people in my district all the time. Thank you very much. My time has expired.
Thank you, Ms. Dalkemper. Dr. Brown is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Ms. Chairman. The famous philosopher Voltaire once said that, quote, the perfect is the enemy of the good, unquote. We use models such as weather forecast every day in our society, knowing that they're not guaranteed to be correct all the time, but accept this based on the importance and utility of the information that the models produce. Dr. Solo, in his testimony, argues that, quote, the DSG model has nothing useful to say, unquote. Hope I quoted you correctly, I think so. Should the economists throw away the DSG model approach outright, or cautiously use the model with understanding that there are limitations and shortcomings for the panel? Dr. Solo, to begin with.
I think it's the latter. I'm not, first of all, a lot depends on what you mean by the DSGE approach. If you simply mean that particular collection of assumptions, then I think there's nothing holy about that, and those assumptions can be discarded the way any set of assumptions could be discarded. If you mean by the DSGE approach being dynamic, being stochastic, and being interested in general equilibrium, then I think that approach can be pursued, although I share Scott Page's view, and I suppose the view of most of us here, that the presumption of equilibrium is a little excessive. But I think there's a lot. I don't want to discard DSGE. The people who do it are among the brightest macroeconomists we have. They're not foolish. I do think that they're neatness freaks like me, and tend to be pushed by their neatness freakery into looking further at this. But I do think it has to loosen up. I do think that one wants to give up the representative agent presumption. I think one has to give up the devotion to equilibrium and keep the broader methodology and let me just add one more thing. In the course of meeting criticisms from sourpusses like me and from the data, the DSGE people have made a lot of modifications, and in the course of doing that, they've done a lot of good work. I'd like to focus on that and give up some more of the more egregious assumptions.
Dr. Cherry, you want to comment?
I think Professor Solow is exactly right. All the interesting policy questions inherently involve understanding the behavior of individuals who are confronted in making decisions that are inherently dynamic, in the sense that if I want to buy a refrigerator or a car, or if I'm a business person planning to invest in plant and equipment, I'm making a decision about incurring costs today in return for future benefits. Dynamics is essential to lots and lots of decisions. Stochastic, in the sense of handling uncertainty, as we all know, is central to decision making. General equilibrium just means making sure that stuff adds up and things are consistent across the way. I don't know. These are innocuous terms. It's hard to, at a conceptual level, to disagree. To say, quite frankly, I don't know what the alternative is. There isn't any out there. Now, within the class of DSGE models, there are a bunch of assumptions that people have made. As I illustrated earlier, early generations made very stringent assumptions. We've thrown away most of those kinds of assumptions. What Scott is asking for example, is that we describe individuals as computer programs that react in predictable ways. There's nothing in the flexibility of the methodology that automatically precludes that. No, it's open to that kind of thing. Here's the problem that modelers confront, and here's the difficulty. The difficulty is that every time we add another ingredient into the model, we want to try and make sure that it's disciplined in some fashion. That is, it is disciplined by historical evidence of the US, other countries, things like that. Both at the micro level and at the macro level. Absent that discipline, you just got a bunch of idle theorists, right, doing completely worthless stuff, right? And I'm an idle theorist too, so I'm all for idle theorists. But it's not the kind of stuff that is going to lead to fundamental improvements. So every time we add a complication to the model, we discipline that complication by focus on an additional piece of data. So, for example, early generations of these models had a representative agent. Modern generations have all kinds of heterogeneity. How do we discipline that heterogeneity? Well, we have data on the wealth of individuals, how the wealth of individuals evolves over time, how the cross-sectional distribution of income evolves over time. That's the kind of stuff that we use to discipline that kind of activity. Early versions didn't have sticky prices or wages. Thanks to important work that Pete Kleena, who was then at the Minneapolis Fed, did with Mark Bells, we now have disciplined, interesting ways of introducing sticky prices and sticky wages. Right? Okay, so these kinds of things, every time things are added, as long as they are added with focus on data, with some discipline in the process of doing it, in general, my reading of the macroeconomics profession is, come on board, the water is, come on to the water, it's fine. The main thing I complain about in my field is, it's amazing how few of us there are. By my count, there are roughly 200, if I was to be very generous, include a lot of people, 500 economists who are actively engaged in the production and the consumption and the interpretation of DSG models. We're talking about, this is an economy of 300 million people with, you know, hundreds of thousands of economists. This is, we're devoting a tiny fraction of our energy to this. Would we be better off if we could quadruple it? Absolutely. Would I be better off if I had four times as many students? Yes. What holds me back? I just don't have the money. I wish I did.
Can I just follow up very quickly? I think that Charlie's raising a really good point, and that there's been this push on these DSG models to include all sorts of things, including heterogeneity and stickiness and frictions and that sort of thing. And I think this relates to your opening comments as well about, you know, studying climate change models. I mean, one thing I think we really need is we don't need one big model, because, you know, every model is going to make mistakes, and one big model is just going to be really hard to understand, and it's going to screw up. What we need lots of models that each include different parts of things, and then we need people who have really sound judgment, who can say, okay, here's our 15 models of the economy. This one is really focusing on heterogeneity. This one's got lots of frictions. This one's got much better sort of firm level detail, right, with sectors of the economy, and have all these models in play with, and then use sort of our judgment and our wisdom and be willing to abandon the notion of stationarity, that the world next week is going to look like it looked the week before, and have a dialogue between those models to make good choices. I think when we lock into a single model, which I think we've done with climate change, and I think sometimes the Fed does, for political reasons, it makes a lot more sense to have the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis or to have the IPCC say, this is what's going to happen, and that's silly, because it's going to be wrong. You know, you're better off saying, here's a whole suite of models, and there's a lot of disagreement about it because this thing is complex. I think we just have to be willing to accept that. I think that's politically difficult to do because people want answers, right?
My time's expired, but, Ms. Chairman, I would like to make a comment, if I may, is that these models are certainly interesting from a theoretical perspective, and you have different economic theories, whether it's Keynesian or supply side, et cetera. And as policymakers, unfortunately, we don't base the policies that we create, and administrations, both Republican and Democrat, try to do the best they can to use whatever tools that they have to try to make this country a better place. And I appreciate y'all's effort and what y'all are doing and trying to give us some modeling and give us some kind of idea about how to proceed. And unfortunately, I think Republicans and Democrats alike don't pay as much attention to unintended consequences of decision-making that we make, and hopefully in this committee, science committee, we have all agreed that science can't create policy, but policy can be created based on scientific evidence and best evidence, and that's what I do as a physician. So I want to thank y'all, my time's run out, and I'll yield back.
Thank you, Dr. Brown. Dr. Brown quoted a philosopher as saying that the enemy of the good is not the bad but the perfect, which is probably the most quoted quotation from a philosopher in Washington, but never with attribution. It was Voltaire, and what politician wants to admit to quoting from a French philosopher?
Mr. Chairman, I want to remind you, I just did.
but not with attribution. Never with attribution. We are seeing the president sign tomorrow a new financial reform bill that will include agencies with new duties, including the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau and a systemic risk council that is supposed to see systemic risk coming, although Alan Greenspan always thought that you could not recognize a bubble while you're in it. You could only recognize a bubble after it had burst. Obviously, we want to improve upon that and recognize bubbles as they are forming and not after they burst. What sort of research will those new regulatory agencies need? Would you urge them to undertake to inform their decisions?
And the problem illustrated in the history of the crisis is that the institutional arrangements of the economy, and particularly in the mortgage markets, changed quite dramatically over a period of, some decades, and then rather rapidly in the final decade of the episode. And basically, the regulatory agencies were to some extent unaware of the extent of these changes and did not have the capacity to try to estimate or understand what the implications of those changes would be. There was this, the Pew Foundation sponsored a very high-level expert task force on financial regulatory reform, which delivered a short report and remarked on this point, which, and I actually quote that remark in my written testimony, saying basically that the system changed a great deal. The regulators were not aware of the extent of this change and its implications. Now, to be aware of those changes, they would have had to had a lot of very high quality economic research going on someplace and presumably in-house, because I don't think it's very likely that that kind of research would be adequately supported elsewhere. So this would bring me back to Dave Colander's remarks about the need to have some greater strength in the domains of applied economics to use the understandings that we accumulate in academic research to address the really significant problems. So I think and suggest in my written testimony that these agencies, and I would include in particular the Fed staff in this respect, needs to have economists who have more of an orientation to the institutional context and the way that it's changing and are interested in trying to estimate the implications of that so that they can provide some useful guidance.
Thank you. Dr. Wynn, I've heard Ben Bernanke say, not so much in defense of why they didn't see the bubble forming, but why they did not act to adopt consumer protections, which the Fed had the authority to do since 1994, is saying that the abuses that became enormous happened fairly quickly, 2004 to 2006. Subprime lending went from 8% of all mortgages to 28% of all mortgages in 2 years. And it was an almost entirely unregulated corner of the market that they didn't see happening. It was not depository institutions that were initiating the loans. They were a conduit to the securitization market, which was almost entirely unregulated, which were investment banks that were not depository institutions. No regulator actually really saw what was happening. So your testimony just now is very consistent with what Chairman Bernanke has said as well. Anyone else wish?
May I comment on that?
Yes, Dr. Winter.
Yes, thank you. So I'm familiar with the sequence of events in the Fed on the matter of subprime lending. And I think an important part of what happened was that there was discussion, there was not action, but there was discussion about the need to protect the borrowers in the context of that episode. Now, I think what was very largely missed was the fact that we had created a system in which the lenders were making dumb loans. That the effect of the securitization process and the general losing track of what was happening to the relevant information created not only the abuse of the borrowers, but a great vulnerability in the lenders.
The loans would not have been dumb if housing had continued to appreciate the way it was appreciating. But that was because even if a borrower couldn't pay it back, when the reset came after just 2 or 3 years and they had to pay 30 to 50% more, in a monthly payment, which they couldn't begin to do, and then they had to pay a prepayment when they got out of that mortgage. If the house had appreciated 15% in those 2 years, there was no realistic possibility they wouldn't pay the full loan. They could either refinance or they could sell their house. But when it stopped appreciating, the music stopped. My time has expired. I now recognize Dr. Brown for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In Dr. Solow's testimony, he said there are other traditions with better ways to do macroeconomics. If macroeconomic models like the DSGE are insufficient, should not be relied upon, what other tools should economists use? Throw that out.
Thank you. I'm glad to take a crack at that. In our discussion here, possibly because it's set up as a discussion of DSGE models, we tend to think as talk as if the choice is, well, you can do DSGE or you can do something else. Dr. Chary suggested, oh, well, DSGE can be a big raft, climb aboard. I don't want to climb aboard. I'd rather have the DSG people take a swim off the raft. There have been and still are long traditions of work, theoretical and applied, in macroeconomics, which have had their ups and downs, but they're not all novelties or things that we ought to try for the first time. My hero in macroeconomics, now alas dead, was James Tobin, Professor James Tobin of Yale University, and a very dear and close friend of mine. Jim Tobin did macroeconomics in a way that paid, I think, just about the right attention to the microeconomic foundations of macroeconomics. He made sure that everything he did was compatible with the truth that what happens macroeconomically is the aggregation of millions of firms and individuals. And one wants only to say things that that are compatible with that and that give reasonable results, that pass the smell test. Tobin, and not only Tobin, but many others besides, left a long body of work which is now all of a sudden forgotten or ignored. And I think that's a terrible mistake. We should simply go, one of the things we should do is continue those traditions. They all worked in terms of aggregate supply and demand in one way or another, and they focused their research on learning more about the components of aggregate demand or learning more about the components of aggregate supply and what happens in markets that fail to match demand and supply. And that's a perfectly sound tradition. It's not something new or untried. We could go back to do that, or do more of that. I would like to see do more of that. One of the problems is that the DSGE model is so attractive, as I said, to the neatness freak in many economists, that it's very hard for anything else to get any traction. And I hope that we can change that. I hope that the misbehavior of the economic system in the past 4 years will help to change that. But we don't have to do something brand new, although I'm game to give agent-based models a run. I'm all for that. There are some new things, but there are some basic existing traditions that could be revived.
Dr. Chary.
I want to go back to my aphorism. If you've got an interesting story to tell and you think it's a coherent story, nothing easier than, or harder, than to try and put it into a model and see if it comes out. If it does, then it's a coherent story. If it does not, then you haven't thought through the economic problem quite as well. These are just very flexible models. Let me give you an illustration of the sense in which they're very, very flexible. There's work which is now by Mike Woodford that's now about 7 or 8 years ago old with Gowdy-Egerton, and a lot of that work has been recently addressed by very prominent macroeconomists, John Taylor, Larry Cristiano, Marty Eichenbaum, a whole bunch of people, all of whom were interested in the following question. When interest rates are really low, you're in a zero interest rate world, so to speak, as we are now, what would be the consequences of big increases in government expenditures? What would be the consequences of various kinds of shocks to the economy? And those models delivered answers that I suspect Professor Solow had in mind when he said, can they generate environments in which there's unemployment because of insufficient demand? Certainly, if you look at the output of those models, it looks that way. Those are models where apparently even wasteful expenditures on government can, in certain circumstances, be desirable. So that's the sense in which it's an open, flexible tool, and I'd argue it would does produce the kind of unemployment that Professor Solow thinks he sees. So all that is all fair game. When I said come on board, what I meant was that if people have an idea, and Scott, for example, has been talking about agent-based modeling, and I think it's intriguing and interesting, and as he recognizes, subject computational limitations, there's really nothing that in the logic of the basic method that prevents you from putting those kinds of features in. What are the kinds of things that then are left out? It's only ideas that are incoherent, arguments that are intended to obfuscate rather than clarify. It's a way of thinking about the world. It does not start off with any presupposition about what the outcomes are. A final observation that's worthwhile keeping in mind whenever you think about all of these things is there are terms like bubble, involuntary unemployment, a variety of different kinds of things, which are theoretical constructs. They can be useful theoretical constructs, but they can also impede us from thinking through what the fundamental issue is. So the fundamental issue is the following. Housing prices in the United States rose dramatically over about a decade-long period and then collapsed dramatically. Is that a bubble or not? That's a hard question to tell. But an inarguable question to tell is, to address is, do you have a model that can produce dramatic increases in housing prices? If you do not have a model that can produce dramatic increases in housing prices, don't come and tell me how we should regulate the housing market. You can't have something interesting to say. Now, in that model, is that dramatic increase in housing prices a bubble? May or may not be. Depends on the details of the particular model. So it is very important for models to be consistent with the data. It is very important for us to be able to write down models where the unemployment rate is sometimes 11% and sometimes 4%. It's less interesting, I think, to ask, in that model, is that unemployed person involuntarily unemployed, voluntarily unemployed? Those are hard questions. It is valid and legitimate to ask yourself the following question. If you asked the actors in the model, would you accept a job at the prevailing wage? You better get a situation where sometimes 11% of them say yes, and sometimes 4% of them say yes. So the way I describe this somewhat more succinctly is, we should judge models by the outcomes that they proceed, not by the particular language that we use to decide whether the outcomes are the outcomes that we want from the models.
Thank you, my time has expired.
Well, Dr. Colander, Ms. Dalkemper is recognized for 5 minutes.
Dr. Solow, your work highlighted the importance of technology as a key driver of economic growth, and Ms. Biggert kind of alluded to that earlier in her questioning. And as we look for budget savings, and you know, we talked about Western Pennsylvania, where I'm from, and manufacturing-based economy in a large part, how should we prioritize spending to guarantee that what we spent represents the best investment for our future?
You really want me to tell you how to do that?
Answers.
You could use your full 5 minutes.
Yeah. Are you speaking primarily of expenditures on science and technology or expenditures broadly?
Well, expenditures broadly.
I think that you ought to, there are two aspects to public expenditures, especially now in the next couple of years. One is that public expenditures of any kind will provide some employment and some secondary expenditure as well, and perhaps at longer term costs in terms of budget, of accumulating debt, will certainly improve the economy. We'll put idle resources to work. That's what I'm trying to get at. The second aspect of public expenditures, which would be true even if there were no idle resources to put to work, are that you have to think in terms, what is the social benefit? What is the benefit to society of spending money on object A as against spending an equivalent amount of resources, of real resources, on B? And in other words, sometimes the cliches are right, and I think that cost-benefit analysis, although a cliche, is the right answer to this question, when all resources are reasonably fully employed. And in my view, and I have no personal interest in this, I think that expenditures on the promotion of innovation in science and technology, including social science and organization and things like that, is our resources well spent in our economy. On the other hand, right now in 2010, I think that almost the dominant fact about public expenditures is that they have a good shot when interest rates are low and staying low of putting idle resources to work. That doesn't obviate the cost-benefit analysis because you can put resources to work in one way or in another. And you, your job as a legislator is to make that judgment for people. It was it Dr. Brown who said that, or quoted someone, I don't know it with attribution or without, that science describes but doesn't prescribe. Well, that's the same is true of economists or in economics. It's your judgment what's the most socially beneficial use of a real dollar's worth or a real $1 million worth of labor and capital in our economy. And that changes time to time. So there's no reason to expect there to be an answer that's valid for 5 years.
Thank you. Yes, Dr. Page.
So, one thing we've all mentioned is that, you know, we think of the economy as the sum of these 300 million people, right? And when you talk about the effects of some of these policies, you're talking about aggregating up over those 300 million people, saying if we spend, you know, X million dollars or billion dollars, we're going to get a 1%, 2%, 3% change in things. And I think it's incredibly important to focus not just on the mean, but also on the variance. As we know, right, this economic downturn has affected people differently across groups, by race, by age, by region. You know, mm-hmm. As you alluded to, it's been very different. And I think that we can sort of, with all good intentions, sort of naively assume sort of a linear view of the world that, you know, if we put this amount of money in, we'll get this nice, clean, linear effect. But if I look through a tighter focus lens and look at the level of particular communities, whether it's by region or age group or by race, you can see that communities can fall apart, right? So there can be these sort of nonlinear threshold type phenomena where entire communities, regions, groups of people can really suffer, right? And so I think that it's very important we think about policy not just to think at the macro level, but also ask how are these things targeted in such a way to prevent really sort of cataclysmic events at the micro scale. Right? We tend to focus on these sort of large events at the macro scale, but the same things are happening at the community level and at the group level, and we need to think of policy, I think, through a finer lens, as opposed to just through these, you know, broad macro models.
Would anyone else like to comment? Dr. Winner?
Yes. sort of the management perspective on these the spending question. You know, one of the difficulties that we face in a circumstance like this, where we're asking what useful lines of government expenditure might be, is that some of them take a lot more time to plan and to get implementation than others do. So it's not just a sort of a cost-benefit analysis in the abstract. You really have to look at the time phasing of the impacts and the requisite levels of administrative investment in order to make it happen. And that line of thinking brings me back to your question about the unemployment benefits, which is a seemingly very reasonable line of expenditure to pursue to renew those benefits with the administrative apparatus to do that already in place and not requiring to be invented. A similar point would apply, I think, to state and local government expenditures, where the state and local governments are doing many things that were deemed to be worthwhile in the past, and they probably are worthwhile now. And the reason they're being cut back is because these governments are so strapped for revenue. So that is another area where, in very short term and with very little new administrative investment, you could make important things happen.
Thank you. My time has expired.
Thank you. We will now have a third round of questions, and I recognize myself for 5 minutes. Dr. Solo, you used the phrase in answer to a question, the weight of the service sector. And I'm not sure you intended that phrase the way I took it at the moment that you said it, that obviously there are many parts of the service sector that make a useful contribution, but some does just feel like a weight. As a brand new member of Congress, hearing Alan Greenspan testify, one member asked him the question, do you think it's important that our economy make things? And like Ms. Dalkemper, I have represented a district where we've lost a lot of manufacturing jobs, so I listened intently. And he said he did not think it was important necessarily that we make things, but the economy add value. And the distinction that I thought he was drawing was to bring in the service sector, but also specifically the financial sector, that it didn't matter quite so much if we lost a lot of textile jobs, if we were the world's financial capital, and we were adding value. Being the world's financial capital now does not seem like such a great deal for us. And some economists have pointed to the growth of the financial sector as a symptom of something wrong, that has gone from 4% to 8%, but most notably the increase in the profitability of having gone from between 5 and 15% of all corporate profits to more than 40, with compensation almost twice what most Americans, the average American worker, is making. Should we regard that as simply the result of self-correcting forces in the current equilibrium, or as symptomatic of something wrong? I'm inclined to view it the way a doctor would view a swollen organ in the body. Anyone, Dr. Solo?
Yes, so am I. In fact, I was going to interject something along those lines earlier, and then I thought I was talking too much, so I shut up. I think the doctor's point of view is the right point of view here, but I think there's a much broader point, especially in connection with financial services. When we were talking about what kind of research new regulatory bodies ought to do, one of the things that I'd like, one of the kinds of research I'd like to see done is this. We've drifted into the habit of talking about the financial services sector as if it justified itself, as if to know and love and earn a lot of money in the financial sector is its own reward. The fact is, God created the financial sector to help the real economy, not to help itself. And one of the kinds of research I'd like to see is a much deeper analysis of the way the financial part of the economy is related to the real economy, to the economy of employment and production and consumption and all that. I suspect, as it seems as if the chairman may suspect, that the financial services sector has grown relatively to the point where it's not even adding value to the real economy. It may be adding compensation to its members, but it's not improving the efficiency or productivity of the real economy. There are clear ways in which financial activity can and does do that. We know from lots of empirical study that for economies at a lower stage of development than the US and Western Europe, financial depth really promotes economic growth. It allocates resources better. It allocates risk better. But I have the feeling, as you seem to have the feeling, that we've got to the point where the financial services sector is creating risk rather than allocating it. So I would like to see research aimed, as I said, at the relation between finance and the real economy, and particularly at what is the productivity in terms of the real economy of resources devoted to financial activity. When I spoke earlier of the weight of the financial sector, I was really simply thinking of the service sector. I was really just thinking of the amount of employment that it generates and the fraction of GDP that it generates, which is both very large and increasing. But I would not take for granted that because the financial sector is large and growing, that it must be profitable in the sense of beneficial to the efficiency and productivity of the real economy.
Okay. Well, my time has expired, but I do have one other question that actually seems pertinent to the work of the committee. If we assume that one of the reasons, perhaps the principal reason we hold hearings, is to inform the decisions that we actually may come before us, one of the things that the federal government does is fund economic research. Dr. Solo just discussed some of the additional research he thought would be useful in informing economic decisions. Dr. Colander has, in his testimony, talked about how we might reallocate the $27 million that we spend in NSF for economic research, which doesn't seem like that much in the scheme of things, given the importance of the issues. Do any of you have a view as well on how we might reallocate those resources? Dr. Solo.
I'll defer to anyone else who wants to say anything about this. In a way, I have to disagree with David about his recommendation. Let me just say that first. I am not, in fact, I'm a little appalled at the idea of appointing physicists and mathematicians and statisticians to review committees for the economics part of NSF. In my excessively long experience, physicists and mathematicians are capable of infinitely more stupidity about the economy than economists are, and not only capable of, but they exercise it that capacity frequently. I do have a small tentative, extremely tentative suggestion of a way in which funds devoted to NSF's economics division might be profitably employed that I think David might agree with. I spoke of earlier traditions in macroeconomics. It seems to me that as of now, those traditions are most carefully practiced not in universities, but in organizations, some of them for-profit firms, which do model building in order to do consulting for private businesses and for government agencies. I know the names of several of those, but that's unimportant. And the Council of Economic Advisors, the Federal Reserve Board, the Congressional Budget Office, all make use of those commercially otherwise maintained macroeconomic models. I wonder whether NSF some, you might provide some funds for NSF that it could spend making grants for basic research done by some of those model building enterprises. And there, I would even like to see the selection committee have representatives from the Council of Economic Advisors, the Federal Reserve Board, the Congressional Budget Office, which have an idea of how to use these models, how they are used, how they might be improved, perhaps by the addition of altogether different agent-based sorts of things. I think that might be a useful thing to do because, as I said, this is where the older traditions in macroeconomics seem to be most practiced these days. Thank you.
Dr. Chari.
So I have served on the NSF's review panel in economics, and I have been a frequent reviewer for various kinds of proposals at the NSF. I have also performed similar tasks at the University of Minnesota, Northwestern University, for our university-wide grant-making activity. I've also participated in some private kinds of things. The NSF's process for allocating funds beats everything else I have seen by a mile. It is exceptionally balanced, it's very fair, very thoughtful. The most striking thing, and I think everybody who's served on an NSF panel always says it, is the bent is always in two directions. The bent is young people. We have to make sure that young people who are coming into the profession get funded, and so therefore we have to take big risks. The second bent is we have to be sensitive to people who have ideas that are seem outside the box. We should not be locked into our way of thinking about things. Of course, we need to apply standards, but we do need to do that. Given that, given my experience dealing with the National Science Foundation, and in any event, given the approximate $2.5 million for macroeconomic research, I don't think there's much to be done by way of reallocation. I would, however, reiterate the case I made in my original spoken testimony. I think given the importance of the issues at hand, given the centrality of these issues for important policymaking, this is an area, at the risk of being a pleader for special interests, this is an area where I do think the social returns to modest increases in funding are likely to be very substantial.
Dr. Winter.
Yeah, first, I'd like to second that last remark of Dr. Chari's. I think it, given the stakes in these issues, I think it's very hard to imagine that we couldn't reasonably try to devote more resources to useful kinds of economic research. But to follow up on Bob Solow's comment about the physicists and mathematicians, an interesting note is that younger generations of those physicists and mathematicians that he spoke of became the Wall Street quants. Yeah. And so the model building that was going on in Wall Street was informed by very high levels of technical skill, but very little of the broader perspective, which one would at least hope that economists might have brought to that situation. And I am more sympathetic to Dave Kohlander's proposal about the review. I think he probably did not have in mind the physicists and mathematicians, that perhaps he did. But there are a lot of social scientists and even management scholars out there who think they know something about the way the world works, and I think their voices in some of those review processes would be helpful.
Thank you, Dr. Kohlander, to defend yourself.
Yes. Let me just say that what I was trying to emphasize, what I think you need diversity within there. I think, as Dr. Chari said, there are 200 people loosely that are considered macroeconomists. If we really got down to it and we were talking over beers, he'd say there's probably about 12, you know, sort of that we take seriously. And the rest, well, you know, they work on the edges and that. What happens is it's a very small area, which means it can get inbred in the sense of here everyone starts to move in lockstep. And that's what I think Dr. Page is emphasizing. Diversity in and of itself is good. And somehow one needs a way of thinking, how can we bring in as many diverse views as possible? So, you know, I can say, well, there's a whole tradition in macroeconomics from Axel Landhofen on coordination failures that all got moved out that really didn't get funded. There's work being done now on saying, look, our knowledge of the macroeconomy is so minute that these models that are formal models are not helping us. So they use fractal co-integrated vector autoregression models. Okay, now you can sort of add that and sort of have that, but they're essentially statistical models. They say, let's pull everything we can from the statistics and use our judgment about theory to add in and not have formal models. So there's differences in methodology. And I think it's that differences in methodology that hasn't been allowed the diversity. Within, once you accept the methodology, I fully, and I've written, that I think the profession is very diverse. You know, they don't hold any particular views, but you've got to accept this methodology. If you don't accept this methodology, you're not part of the economics profession. That is what I'm saying is wrong, because the methodology is itself questionable. And the question is really here, it has to have micro foundations, if it's going to be there, but of a particular type, of an equilibrium type. In other words, if you think of things broadly, every economist believes incentives are important. But the way they approach it is here within the system that's created by the macroeconomy, you're operating within that. In which case the micro foundations have macro foundations, which have micro foundations, and they feed back, and you're not sure where it is. So therefore, you have no distinct methodology that you allow. Now, I don't know what's right, but what I'm saying is a way to sort of have the system arrive at that is to maintain the diversity, and that the current system is not allowing for that diversity. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Colander. If we start using those other models that you described or mentioned, could you come up with some initials for those? That would I now recognize Dr. Brown for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Ms. Chairman. Just for the sake of expediency, I'm going to submit my further questions to the panel, and I appreciate y'all's written response to that. So I'm going to submit my further questioning for written response to the panel, and I'll just yield back.
Thank you. I think we are. Dr. Page, did you have anything to add to that last question? It is something that actually is within the jurisdiction of this committee. So perhaps we should talk about that a little bit. If you have a thought on the direction in which the government-funded economics research should head.
Yeah, I think it's always risky to sort of ask people off the top of their head, you know, what should we do within an agency? I think you always get better decisions if you sort of task people to think about it beforehand and bring sort of people with different vested interests and different training to think about it. But I think one thing that's interesting is that we haven't within economics thought about could there be, you know, sort of big new funding initiatives. You know, one thing that the NSF did, I think, has been very successful is these IGRT grants, right, with these integrative graduate education research training grants where you set up sort of these interdisciplinary graduate training programs across the sciences. And these have, I think, really transformed graduate education in a lot of ways. We haven't done similar things within economics. I mean, there's some, I have one of these, which is partially within an economics department. University of Michigan actually has two. But we haven't sort of issued anything of grand challenges or just real opportunities to say to the economics division within the NSF, suppose we gave you $10 million, right, for a one-time only event, how would you use the money? So rather than just sort of come up with a program, give them an opportunity and let economists and sociologists and people who know financial markets and people who study organizations, you know, but task an interesting diverse group of people with coming up and saying, what do you think we could give and what would the bang for the buck be and how large are the stakes, as opposed to sort of, you know, someone getting on a hobby horse and saying, this is my idea, let's do it. Because I think that there's a lot of really bright people who care deeply about these things, and I think with resources, we could be very innovative. The reason we're not being as innovative as we could be now is it's a very small pie, and there's a lot of incredibly talented people, and there's a lot of people with, you know, strong agendas, and I think that the economics division, like most of the division, does a very decent job of dividing that up. But there hasn't been a sense of here's something interesting, you know, here's an opportunity, you know, here's a pile of money. What could you do? And if you brought, you know, some, I think, bright, diverse minds together, something interesting would probably come out.
Okay. Thank you. I think we are now to the end of our hearing.
May I make a comment, Mr. Chairman, just to go back to what Dr. Page is saying.
Dr. Brown.
I bet if we gave each one of you $10 million, the money would be utilized in some manner or another. So I trust that that would happen. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Dr. Brown. And Dr. Brown, I will make an agreement with you that if you do not tell voters in North Carolina that I've gone to Washington to start quoting French philosophers, I will not tell voters in Georgia that you have as well.
Are you asking for unanimous consent request here? So, I will agree.
Thank you. The hearings that I have grown to like the best are when they're really smart, thoughtful people whose testimony agrees with what I already think. I don't claim expertise in economics, but a great legal philosopher, Oliver Wendell Holmes, wrote that the life of the law has not been logic, the life of the law has been experience. The lesson that I take from your testimony is that we do need logic, as we need logic in law. But if experience pulls us up short for where logic appears to lead us, we should listen to the logic, to the experience. Whether it's a smell test that Dr. Solo, whether we call it a smell test or otherwise, if the result of the application of logic leads to an unacceptable result or one that does not make sense, then we should pause over it. And certainly a lot that went on in the economy in the last 10 years looked at in isolation made no sense. And explaining that it could not be looked at in isolation, had to be looked at as it's a broader part of a broader macro economy in which the little pieces all made sense, and there were self-correcting forces, and there was an equilibrium, and we couldn't tamper with it, or we would be tampering with mysterious forces that were beyond our knowledge. That proved not to be a good policy course. We would have been better dealing with the injustices, the things that in isolation appeared to make no sense. I do appreciate very much this very distinguished panel coming today. It would be great if you could continue to be available to us as we have questions in this area. I appreciate all of you being here. I think I now have a script for the closing. Yes. Before we bring the hearing to a close, I want to thank our witnesses for testifying. I think I already said that extemporaneously, but now let me also say it from the script. Before our subcommittee today, under the rules of the committee, the record will remain open for 2 weeks for additional statements from the members and for answers to any follow-up questions the subcommittee may have for the witnesses. And having heard the testimony, I do not think that there is any possibility of any problems with possible perjured testimony. The witnesses are excused, and the hearing is now adjourned.